He blocked the shot. Happy Friday afternoon and welcome to the Department of State. This week we had the U.S.-China Human Rights Dialogue here at the in Washington, and here to give you a summary of our discussions and perhaps describe a little bit about the path forward. We have Assistant Secretary Mike Posner. Before Mike comes up, obviously you heard from the Secretary a while ago in her very first meeting with the new Foreign Secretary of the United Kingdom, William Hague. Be happy to chat afterwards on any other details of that meeting if you feel you need it. Anyway, we'll start off with Mike. Thanks.
Good afternoon. I'm going to just give you few background details about the dialogue. We met yesterday and today. I was joined by Deputy Secretary Steinberg, by Jeff Bader from the National Security Council, Undersecretaries Otero, Hormats, Kurt Campbell, Assistant Secretary for East Asia and Pacific Affairs, other colleagues here at the State Department and AID, but other agencies too participated, Department of Justice, Homeland Security, Labor, Commerce, IRS, U.S. Trade Representative's Office, and members of the judiciary. The Chinese delegation was led by Director General Chen Shu, who's the Director General in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs Department of International Organizations. They had nine agency representatives from their ministries of justice, public security, State Administration of Religious Affairs, Supreme Court. Yesterday we were here, we had a variety of discussion on a variety of topics, including religious freedom, labor rights, freedom of expression, rule of law, racial discrimination, and multilateral cooperation. We also discussed a number of individual cases. Today we visited several sites in Washington. We met this morning with Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, who hosted us at the Supreme Court to discuss rule of law and the role of lawyers in society. We met with Cardinal McCarrick at Catholic Charities Anchor Mental Health Center to talk about the relationship between the religious community and government in human services, social services, humanitarian issues. We also met with officials of the Federal Mediation and Conciliation Service to discuss labor rights, collective bargaining. And we met at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, where Tom Carruthers hosted a delegation there to talk about the nexus between human rights, rule of law, and food safety. The discussions we had were candid and constructive, including a range of areas where we disagree. We plan to continue the discussions in a variety of fora, including a legal experts dialogue, and we agreed to set the dates and agenda to restart those discussions soon. We also agreed to a next round of this dialogue to be held in China in 2011, and we are discussing further expert discussions both on religious freedom issues and on labor. I look forward to working with our Chinese counterparts to continue these discussions. I'll open up, yes.
Foster Kluge, I work for the Associated Press. I was hoping you could talk specifically about what cases you raised, if you could give us any idea of China's response, whether they agreed to any concessions or to look into your areas of concern, and then also to talk a little bit about what you expect China to do. Ambassador Huntsman this morning mentioned work projects over the next year, which he described as a way to show that this just isn't talk, it's actual progress. Could you talk about that?
Sure. You know, again, I think I sort of view this discussion as operating on two tracks. On the one hand, we are advancing discussions, for example, on rule of law issues, where there is, I think, real possibility of dialogue, shared experience, and mutual interest in having both these expert dialogues and other areas where we work together. And as I say, we're going to try to do that in the religious area. We're going to try to do it in the labor area and perhaps others. On a parallel track, and Ambassador Huntsman today said, and I think it's right, the sign of a mature relationship between our two countries is that we're also able to discuss our differences in a candid but respectful way, in an honest way, in a detailed way. We talked about a whole range of cases. I'm not going to go into the details of them, but we will continue to raise our concerns about specific cases, and the fact that we have this dialogue provides one opportunity. It's not the only one to do it. But I think the more we can regularize these discussions and make them more part of the routine dialogue between our two countries generally, the more likely we're going to get success.
Why can't you talk about the specific cases that you raised? The spokesman often mentions things that that the State Department is concerned about in China. Why not lay out what you mentioned?
You know, I think for two reasons. One, we talked about a large number of cases, and those cases are in very different places. In some cases, I think we're going to be more effective if we continue the discussion privately. There's other cases. I can mention Liu Xiaobo, this case I've mentioned before. We raised it. We're going to continue to raise it. In that case, I think our judgment is that it's important for us to be publicly reiterating our concern. Gao Zhisheng is another, the lawyer, whose case we've expressed concern about, we'll continue to do. So I cite those as examples. I don't want to go into every case, but we genuinely are committed and spend time discussing very specific cases and very specific concerns in the areas where our disagreements are most profound. Yes.
Sir, thank you. There were some demonstrations here at the State Department from the Falun, the religious persecution in China, and also concerning for the Tibetans, monks also, asking for freedom, or at least religious freedom. Have you also spoken with them as far as the freedom of the press?
We did indeed. We had a discussion yesterday afternoon on free expression. We talked about that issue in its broadest terms, including restrictions on the press, on journalists, on bloggers, on internet. That's the broad subject that we were discussing, and there clearly are real differences there. But we had a good and a detailed discussion of all those things.
May I just follow quickly? One more.
Yeah.
Sir, thank you. There is a concern among many Chinese who live here, and they have families back home, and many of them are blacklisted, or they cannot even travel to China, and their families live underground. Does these issues come ever that, because many Chinese who live here, like Tibetans and others, they like to visit back home?
We discussed, again, in the context, I don't want to get into every detail of what we discussed, but we certainly raised our concerns both about restrictions on religious freedom in those places and broader human rights concerns, and we'll continue to do that. Yeah.
Was the response of Chinese on your concerns on human rights violation in Tibet any different from their previous versions?
You know, this is the first time that I've had this dialogue, and so the last one was in 2008. The last one before that was in 2002, and I think one of the things I'm very eager to do is make this, as I said, a more regular exchange, because I think it'll enhance our ability to have these discussions in a way that's going to get a greater result.
Are you satisfied with the Chinese response in Tibet, the human rights violations?
No, look, what I am pleased about is that we had a good 2 days of discussions, respectful in tone, and at the same time direct in content. And so there are issues, a range of issues, where we can work together, but a number of issues, including some that you're mentioning here, where we have differences. Those differences were very clear. They were very plainly expressed. There are a number of places where I can assure you in 2 days we're not going to change major policies or major points of view, but we laid a foundation to continue those discussions, and we will continue them. Yes.
Can you elaborate on what you talk about internet freedom, especially Google issue?
We spoke in broad terms about the issue of internet freedom. We didn't speak about particular companies or details of that nature. You know, the Secretary's speech in January articulated a U.S. government policy which promotes an unfettered open internet across the globe. We view that as a human rights issue. It's a reaffirmation of our commitment to free expression, and our desire in China and everywhere is for there to be people have the ability to use the internet both to gather information and to disseminate information. And clearly those are issues where we have a range of concerns.
Yeah. I guess a bit more broadly, there's been some criticism that perhaps this coming ahead of the strategic and economic dialogue, that this could be sort of a side issue, the Chinese could listen to the concern, say thank you very much, and then move on, and it wouldn't really go anywhere. Do you feel confident that actually these discussions you've had in the past 2 days have actually achieved something that either in the short term or the long term can be a deliverable?
Yeah, you know, I view this as laying a foundation for me and Director General Chun to continue to have conversations, and for these to become a more regular pattern so that we can exchange ideas and concerns and look for ways to cooperate, all of those things. I also think it's critically important that the human rights issues be part, and I think they are part, of a broader U.S. engagement and policy in China. It's significant to me that we had representatives from the Commerce Department and from the White House and from the IRS and the Trade Rep and the Labor Department and the Justice Department. It's also important to me that I'll be going to Beijing next week to be part of the U.S. Delegation to the dialogue there. And I'll continue to discuss these issues. You know, we talk about a whole-of-government approach. We need to take a whole-of-government approach to human rights generally, and in this case, in particular. So I'm confident that we're moving in that direction. Did we today and yesterday, did we resolve that issue? No, we've got a lot of work to do, but I know that I have the commitment of the Secretary and the President to make human rights part of our ongoing dialogue with the Chinese. Yep.
Was there any areas in which China sort of turned the tables and raised its own complaints or concerns about U.S. practices around the globe or at home? Can you give some examples there?
Sure. You know, I think, again, this goes back to Ambassador Huntsman's comment. Part of a mature relationship is that you have an open discussion where you not only raise the other guy's problems, but you raise your own and you have a discussion about it. We did plenty of that. We had experts from the U.S. side, for example, yesterday talking about treatment of Muslim Americans in an immigration context. We had discussion of racial discrimination. We had a back and forth about how each of our societies are dealing with those sorts of questions. So throughout the day yesterday and again today, we had a discussion about the relationship of food safety, law, human rights today. Food safety is an issue, as our experts told us this afternoon, a big issue in the United States, and it's an issue in China. And in some cases, we're talking about the same thing. We had a discussion yesterday about labor inspections. Well, it turns out that there aren't enough labor inspectors in factories either in China or the United States. Maybe that's something we can work on together. So I think the tone of the discussions was very much not, we've got all the answers, we're telling the Chinese how to behave. It was framed in an international context, international standards, we're both obligated, and let's talk about things that we're both dealing with and try to figure out, can we help each other? And where we have differences, how do we mitigate those differences? Yeah.
It's a follow-up about the Liu Xiaobo's case. Did you request about immediate release to Chinese side?
I'm not going to get into the details. We've expressed in the past, you know, our concern about the nature of the detention, and we certainly continue to be concerned about the fact that he's in prison.
Did the recently passed Arizona immigration law come up? And if so, did they bring it up or did you bring it up?
We brought it up early and often. It was mentioned in the first session, and as a troubling trend in our society, and an indication that we have to deal with issues of discrimination or potential discrimination, and that these are issues very much being debated in our own society.
Did they bring it? Did they discuss anything about their concerns about Chinese visiting in Arizona? Any concerns raised?
No, that was not raised.
Okay.
Yes.
Could you be more specific on your talks concerning Tibet and Xinjiang, and was the Dalai Lama raised?
There were a range of issues raised about in the context of our discussions of religious freedom, ability to practice freely and without constraint, and certainly we raised some specific cases from both of those regions.
Did you also raise Falun Gong issue, talking about the religious freedom?
Yeah, again, you know, some of the lawyer cases involve lawyers who've been either disbarred or had their licenses not renewed. Zhishang is one who's in prison or detained because these are people who've represented Falun Gong. So in the context of due process, rights of criminal defendants, we raised those issues. Yes.
I'm Kristen Jones from the South China Morning Post. Did you learn anything specifically about Gao Zhisheng's whereabouts or the status of his case?
Again, I'm not going to get into the details of any of those discussions.
Are there any specific benchmarks or expectations that you set that you'll expect to be met in the coming months as your talks go forward?
Well, I think as far as I'm concerned, the first benchmark is that we get the legal dialogue underway. We do it in the next few months. We are eager to work also on these parallel discussions on labor issues and on religious issues. I think it's important on a parallel track, again, that we continue to track some of these, both individual cases, but also some of the other more systemic concerns that we raised, and we'll do so. Somebody asked before about, you know, the criticism that, well, we meet every couple of years and that's the place we discuss it. My intention is to make this a more regular, a more normal kind of a conversation. And my going out there next week is an effort to meet, you know, with some officials and others to get a better picture of what's going on. And I want us to be able, as we do with every country in the world, to be able to raise our concerns, but also look for areas of cooperation. Yeah, the bear.
Round of talk.
We had a range of discussions of prisoners. I'm not going to go any farther than that. Yeah.
Was there any talk about China's expatriation of North Korean refugees to North Korea?
Eric Schwartz joined us at lunch. He and I both raised a number of issues involving North Korea and Cambodia, Burma. And, you know, I think, again, this is an area, maybe another area, where a more regular discussion about refugee protection issues could be a very useful thing. And we're certainly following those cases, and we'll continue to raise them. Yeah.
Did you get a decision whether this talk will be regularized as you expected?
Yeah, I think I'm encouraged by that. Again, the Director General, Shun, invited me back to Beijing to be part of a dialogue next year, which I gladly accepted. I think that's the right direction. I'd like to make it I think it ought to be at least on an annual basis. But we're going to take one step at a time. And so, you know, rather than having this kind of lurching between is it every other year, is it every 6 years, we're now committed to doing it, both of us, in 2011. I think that's a good thing. But it shouldn't just be 2 days of talks every year. And that's why I think these, the more we kind of filter these out into different expert agendas or areas where we're having ongoing discussions about law reform, about labor, about whatever, I think we're more likely to make real progress over time. We didn't set a time. Sometime next year. Yes.
Excuse me. So is there any particular case did you have any consensus as a fruit of this meeting? Or the conversation today is just kind of express of your what you were thinking about?
Well, if you mean specific case of
any
somebody...
Any progress on a specific case?
Are you talking about a prisoner case?
Yeah, including prisoners or any particular case like Tibet or Xinjiang or anything.
You know, my goal in coming into this meeting was to set up a process by which we will have more regular communication. We will find areas where we can agree to meet on a regular basis with experts to talk about a deeper substantive set of issues, and at the same time to regularize these discussions through the dialogue. Where specific cases are raised, but to raise specific cases throughout the year. We will continue to do that. I didn't expect, and there's certainly, I think it would have been, I would have been surprised if we had a resolution of something in a two-day talk, yeah.
I know it was your first round, and there's been a long gap since previous rounds, but I assume you were briefed on how the previous ones go. What surprised you the most about the Chinese posture, stance, attitude? Did anything surprise you?
I was encouraged by the degree to which we had a back and forth dialogue. You know, I come out of the NGO world, and I have spent a lot of time in frustrating meetings where it feels that everything is scripted, and I'm always like, let's get to the real issues. We were talking about the real things. People weren't giving long recitations without a back and forth. We really had a discussion about both issues where we can agree and where we can move forward in a cooperative way, but we also had a real dialogue, a constructive dialogue, respectful in tone, but very direct about things where we don't agree. That's encouraging to me. And, you know, also, it was interesting to me this morning when we went to see Sandra Day O'Connor at the Supreme Court. She spoke very movingly about the important role that lawyers play in this society, in the criminal justice system, the importance we attach to the independence of the judiciary, the independence of lawyers, the importance of pro bono representation. Sitting in that august setting, you really get a sense. I was really proud to be there, and I think that our Chinese guests undoubtedly got a sense from that this is pretty deeply imbued in our society. So things like that were... it was interesting and encouraging to me that we were able to have discussions like that I think took it to another level.
Sure. It's Sandra Day O'Connor, the former justice.
That's right. Yeah. Somebody has to ask a question.
Now that the two countries come back to the human rights dialogue, will the United States propose a resolution in the United Nations Human Rights Council in the future?
A resolution about?
About China's human rights record.
Well, you know, I don't know that there's any plan to do that. We did have a good discussion about the Universal Periodic Review, which the Chinese government undertook last year, which we're undertaking this year. We talked about some areas where, again, areas where we have differences, but also areas where we have some similarities or some shared interests. Traditionally, the Human Rights Council has been for us an uphill battle on these issues, but we'll continue to press. And I think it's good, again, that we're able in this context to talk with them both about places where we can cooperate as well as places where we're going to have different points of view.
We'll take one or two more and then we'll call it a day.
Yes.
Many human rights groups criticize that the dialogue is not transparent or open enough. So do you expect something to be changed in the future, more in this direction, or...
You know, again, I come out of the human rights world, and I used to be one of those people saying that, so I don't know what to say here. The truth is, there is a value in having a a conversation, direct conversation between the two governments. There are a range of things that we said and discussed that need to be said, and we did say, in a, again, a respectful but direct way. I think that serves a purpose. I also believe, and to the extent that we can encourage this, that there is a real value in opening up the dialogue to involve civil society and, you know, academics and rights groups and environmentalists and whoever else, experts, legal experts. So, you know, if we can succeed in establishing, again, this more mature relationship, I think there's room for a more open process on some of the issues that we were discussing and to really have a more robust discussion with people who aren't just government representatives and a more open discussion. Yeah, and the...
Yeah. China that the United States expect regularize the meeting?
No, we didn't tell China anything. We really, this was a discussion among two important countries. Again, the idea here is how do we find ways to work together on areas where we have the potential to mutually benefit, and how do we find a way to address our differences and mitigate those differences. Again, the tone of this is real important, and it was important to me as much as a lot of the things we were saying expressed very serious concerns about very real issues. The tone of the discussion was very much, we're two powerful, great countries. We have a range of issues that we are engaged with on. Human rights is part of that discussion, and it's going to remain so, and we're going to continue to press on the things that we hold dear.
We'll make this the last one.
Hi, Kathy Chan, Wall Street Journal. I had two quick questions. One is, when you're in Beijing next week, are you planning to meet with, besides meeting with officials, are you planning to meet with any activists, dissident types, to hear the other side of the story? And secondly, sorry if I missed this, I came in a little late. Could you talk a little more specifically about some of the legal cooperation you're looking to push forward on, if there are any specifics on that?
Sure. On the first question, you know, whenever I travel, and I do a lot, I make it my business to meet a range of people. I'm not going to say more than that. On the legal dialogue, you know, I think there are a range of issues in China now, and we discuss them in some detail, where law reform is being discussed, new laws are being proposed. There are a range of issues where implementation of existing laws is being discussed in basic contract law, for example, from 2008, and there are a range of challenges to how those laws get implemented. So I think there's an interest on their part and ours both to talk about laws that are being proposed or being debated, as well as the implementation. And a third area where inevitably there needs to be and will be discussion is the role of lawyers, the role of the judiciary. So I think we can be, we will be looking for ways to kind of integrate those three aspects. Thanks, everybody.
I'm this is the part of the week, I think the Germans call it Feierabend, which a German friend of mine once translated as Miller time. So, I mean, I'll take a couple of quick questions. I don't know that we need to extend the work week any much further. Go ahead.
Depending on human rights issues.
You just had the assistant secretary.
This month, there has been 4 or 5 big demonstrations, anti-Iran demonstrations in Afghanistan, including Kabul, in which people have accused Iran of violating human rights of Afghan refugees living in Iran. And today there was a big demonstration by Afghan Americans at the United Nations also. Is it an issue of concern about violation of human rights of Afghan refugees living in Iran? A lot of them have been executed. A number of them been put behind bars in recent months.
Well, we have expressed a number of times our concern about Iran's human rights record, not only concerns about what it is doing inside its own borders to its own people, but also how it is acting not constructively in other parts of the world. It's in that region or also in the Middle East. So, yes, we have tremendous concerns about Iran and its its human rights record. One of the reasons we worked very significantly behind the scenes and were gratified that Iran was not granted a seat on the Human Rights Council.
Do you have any update on Secretary's trip to Asia? Is she going to South Korea and Japan after China?
The Secretary actually had a trip meeting this afternoon. I think we'll be making some final decisions, and we'll be announcing the schedule early next week prior to her departure. So we're pretty close to setting the trip, but we're not prepared to announce the schedule yet.
What are your concerns about reports that Al-Qaeda members have been able to travel more freely in and out of Iran?
We've long had concerns about Al-Qaeda members, Al-Qaeda leaders who have been residing in Iran. Iran is probably the most significant state sponsor of terrorism in the world, and this is just another indication of it.
Movement, there were working talks on Futenma this week, working-level talks. Has there been any conclusion or movement
We have not reached a conclusion. I think we were satisfied with the meetings this week, and we will continue to work with the Japanese government at a variety of levels on those details.
This morning, at the morning press briefing earlier, the British Foreign Secretary spoke about the discuss on how U.S. and Britain can coordinate on Pakistan issues. Can you give us a little more detail about it? What were discussed and how do you plan to coordinate?
As the Secretary and the Foreign Minister said, it was a very detailed discussion. It started with about a 10-minute one-on-one discussion with the Secretary, and then joined by staff on both sides. We had a working lunch and went back and forth, as the Secretary outlined in her remarks. Afghanistan was a significant topic. Iran was a significant topic. Did get to Pakistan. Obviously, the United Kingdom has its own very strong relationship with Pakistan, and traded some ideas on how we could work cooperatively, and also how the United Kingdom could have its own dialogue with Pakistan on issues of mutual concern, including security. David?
Any recent conversations with the Brazilians about Lula's trip?
Yeah, this is one I just kind of missed. The Secretary had a discussion with Foreign Minister Amarim on Tuesday. I just missed the readout of that call, so I apologize for not catching that earlier and passing it on. But so she did have a conversation with him. That, in turn, followed up on a conversation she had in New York at the opening of the NPT conference earlier this month. And as the Secretary herself said upstairs, we will look to see what happens this weekend.
The Indian Foreign Minister is also visiting Iran this weekend, part of the same thing. Have you reached out to India at any level on the same issue on Iran?
Not to my knowledge. Iran did come up in the context of the discussion that we had this week with President Karzai. Since obviously Afghanistan is a neighbor of Iran, we are touching, in a wide range of discussions with a wide range of countries, we'll be watching closely to meetings that occur in Tehran this weekend. But as the Secretary said, we are skeptical that Iran is going to change course, and as she also said, we believe that it is time to apply more pressure to Iran. And that, we think, is the best way to get them to engage more seriously.
Can you confirm reports that Ambassador Chris Hill is slated to retire this summer?
Chris Hill is working very hard in Iraq. Whenever there are changes in ambassadors overseas, those announcements come from the White House.
Two questions. One. For the first time, Pakistan government spoke out, and they are saying that this Times Square bomber has no connection with or in Pakistan. But U.S. agencies are saying differently.
Well, actually, if you read the morning paper, Pakistan has made some arrests in connection with this investigation. So I think that speaks for itself.
You want to confirm the arrest?
your suggestion.
No, man, it's a simple.
Yeah, on those issues, I'll defer to Justice.
Oh, come on.
Come on.
It's Friday.
It's Friday afternoon. You've got it here. You've got the only podium in town.
Well, I'll tell you what, Charlie. I mean, before we wrap up, I do not want us to overlook the fact that the Secretary met today with President Zedkaya of the Marshall Islands. Gordon was in that meeting and indicates that the primary topic of conversation was global warming, as you would expect. But we obviously welcome the friendship that the Marshall Islands have with the United States going back many, many years.
Repeat the question. In case you're forgetting.
So the diversion didn't work. Huh?
No.
I'll defer to Justice.
One more on China, please. Back on human rights.
You had the Assistant Secretary here, Goyal, and you had questions of him.
I know this is kind of different. Maybe you can answer. Thank you. I know it's Friday. You have to go for the weekend parties
I have many miles to trot before the weekend comes.
When you talk with Chinese, do you talk ever about prison labor? Because there is a concern in this country by the human rights groups and also by the labor groups, and also at the same time, talking about human rights with China also concerns different neighboring countries like Burma and North Korea and Iran and all those, because Chinese have connections with those countries, mm-hmm. and they share the same values.
Sure, absolutely. As Mike Posner, was talking about, this was about China. This was about issues that in the region that also affect China. Look, the challenge that China faces on the labor front is shared by other countries in the region that have export economies, and over time you can have both. You can have economic growth. You can have rising labor standards. It is in everyone's interest, to move in that direction. These are the kinds of issues we have with a wide range of countries. One, two, then we'll wrap it up. Go ahead.
So is there any readout about today's 2+2 meeting between U.S. and ROK? And the Cheonan ship sinking incident, how did you discuss about that matter?
Oh, in the I haven't got a readout of that meeting, so we'll take that question, see if we can get some sort of readout. But obviously we are cooperating fully in the investigation. I would probably expect that it did come up in the discussion today, but we will continue to support the investigation until it reaches a conclusion.
The same question as well: whether Secretary Clinton's visit is also related to Cheonan incident.
I'm sorry, again.
Secretary Clinton is visiting Korea.
We haven't announced her travel. Yet.
Whether her trip to Korea is related to some of the extra additional findings of the Cheonan incident.
I wouldn't link the two directly together. The investigation is ongoing in South Korea. I think it's in the final stages. And we will be talking to South Korea about that investigation and its implications. I can come back in today's meeting. Assistant Secretary Campbell and Assistant Secretary Gregson met with South Korean diplomatic and defense officials for preparatory discussions of important bilateral issues related to our alliance. That doesn't tell you much, but I think in the full range of bilateral and multilateral discussions, I think I'm confident that various issues related to North Korea came up. I'm sure the Cheonan investigation came up. I'm confident that they also talked about ongoing plans in terms of our ongoing defense cooperation and changes that we're discussing about the nature of the alliance. So I'm sure that was probably the primary nature of the discussion. As for the secretary, when she's in the region, obviously we focus on our strong alliances. We'll have more to say about her trip early next week. But as to, you know, let's wait. Let's leave it there.
Just one final one on Thailand. Yes. If there's any update on the situation there, particularly with the closing of the embassy, and your perceptions of how things stand on the ground right now.
I mean, we are deeply concerned about the situation on the ground in Thailand. We continue to strongly encourage everyone involved, everyone engaged, to show restraint and to find a way to work peacefully, through these differences, and do so in a way that strengthens democratic institutions. I anticipate that our embassy will remain closed through the weekend and probably Monday as well.
Are all personnel there accounted for, or any injuries?
I'm not aware of any injuries. Have a nice weekend.